The Kiss of Life: How a Superhero and My Son Defeated Cancer by Emraan Hashmi with Bilal Siddiqui, read by Akshay Ghildiyal. To my son, my superhero, Ayyan, learning from your confidence, courage and resilience, I have grown as a person. Mama ji and Choti auntie, the two pillars of my life, you both might have gone, but your memory will live on in our hearts and minds forever. I also dedicate this to all the cancer patients who are battling the disease. My family and I offer you our prayers. A piece of advice from us: hope and the will to survive will get you through every adversity. I'm Batman. Who is this? I waited for a split second before answering him. I needed to make sure I replied to him in the right voice. He might be young, but he's very sharp. I am Batman, I replied in a low, gruff tone. Is that Ayyan? There was a pause. I could imagine his eyes widen with disbelief. Yes, is that really Batman? How are you, Ayyan? I'm okay, Batman. Are you fighting crime in Gotham? Papa told me. A lump formed in my throat. I decided to tell him what I had called him for in the first place. Would you like to become a superhero like me, Ayyan? He breathed heavily with excitement. I could hear it over the phone. Yes. Then listen to me very carefully. It will take some time, but once we are done, you are going to become better than Iron Man. You will be Ayyan Man. I knew Ayyan loved Batman, but I had already donned that cape. If I had offered him the chance to be Batman, he wouldn't have quite liked the idea of us playing the same superhero. The incongruity would get to him. That's how I decided we'll pronounce his name in a new way that resembled another one of his absolute favorites, Iron Man. Okay, he replied. What will I have to do? Listen to me very carefully, Ayyan. 5 minutes later, when I walked into the room, I saw him playing with his superhero figurines on the bed. He looked up at me sheepishly. I looked back at him and raised an eyebrow. He was brimming over with excitement, fighting the urge to tell me what had just happened. Daddy, guess who called? I sat beside him hurriedly, playing along. Who? I whispered, looking at his big brown eyes attentively. Batman, he grinned. He told me how to become a superhero. I gasped, exaggeratedly matching his level of excitement, then leaned forward and hugged him tight. My son was going to be a superhero. A light shower fell on the bustling streets of Mumbai as I leaned against a wall in the grim-looking corridor. A drizzle in January was quite uncommon, but it was that kind of day. A morose afternoon that we conjure up in films so well, often accompanying it with a soft, soulful background track. But this was no film. It was reality. My eyes looked out of the window, tracing the distant splash of rain on the helpless commuters. I felt lonely and isolated from them. Their lives seemed so much better than mine. Here I was, at the Hinduja Hospital in Mahim, surrounded by my family. Everything would be okay, they kept telling me. I wanted to believe them. It was 14th January 2014, the beginning of an unexpected journey. As I heard the creak of the little stretcher that wheeled Ayyan towards the operating theatre, my grip around Parveen's wrist tightened. She followed Ayyan into the freezing air-conditioned room with whitewashed walls, with me in tow. It was the kind of clinical environment I detested. The smell of disinfectant took me back to the days my grandmother was battling for her life in the intensive care unit not too long ago. I looked at all my family members, my mother, my cousin Smiley Suri, Kumkum Sehgal, who I referred to as Chotu Masi, my childhood buddy Sharan, waiting outside. They anxiously nodded in support before we stepped in. The doctors were going to operate upon him. We looked at our little baby, sedated, completely unaware of the grave battle that he was about to fight. The staff had removed his favorite Batman t-shirt and replaced it with a small green hospital gown. I kissed his forehead gently and placed a taviz, an amulet, around his neck. Sorry, sir, one of the nurses addressed me as I did this. It's a sterile environment. You'll have to remove it. I did as I was told and clutched the amulet tightly in my hand. Parveen gave him a tight hug before we stepped out of the room. As if on cue, my phone vibrated. It was Mahesh Bhatt, my uncle. Yes, Bhatt Sahab, I said meekly. Bhatt Sahab has a way of sensing things. That's probably why he called me at the right time to say what I needed to hear. Emmy, he said. I'm telling you again, he's going to be fine. There was a long pause. I could still not speak. His voice boomed again. Emmy, he's going to be fine. It was then that I couldn't hold back. Before I realized it, tears began streaming down my face. I have always been someone who shies away from showing my true emotions, especially during moments when I am vulnerable. But I had never felt this helpless in my life. I remembered the night before, when we had tricked Ayyan into believing that we had checked into a hotel. I had met the doctors and nurses in an adjoining room so that he didn't overhear my conversation with them. Once I was back to his room, he threw a fit when he was given the insipid hospital food. He demanded pizza and all the other junk that got him happy. It took us some time to get him to settle down, after which he asked me a simple question. Is it my birthday or is it Christmas, Papa? He inquired earnestly. Is that why we are in a hotel? To celebrate? Yes, Ayyan, I replied. It's gonna be your birthday soon and we will celebrate many, many more birthdays together. My four-year-old baby boy was diagnosed with second-stage Wilms' tumor, a type of cancer that affects the kidneys and typically occurs in children. Wilms' tumor is very uncommon. Children of African origin are relatively more prone to suffer from it than other children. It is named after a German doctor, Max Wilms, who wrote one of the first medical articles about the disease in 1899. It would seem unfortunate for a man to have a damned disease named after him, because at that moment I disliked the word itself. I shuffled nervously, transferring my weight from one foot to the other, waiting to find out what would happen next. I looked at my wife standing beside me. Parveen was composed and certainly more in control than I was. She is a strong woman. Although it was all a facade, but it required more than mere bravery to look that stoic. My forehead, on the other hand, was creased with anxiety. My heart thumped away so loudly that I feared it would resound in a tormented echo. Here I was, Emraan Hashmi, the actor known to wear different masks for a living, fighting to keep a straight face. But given the turmoil that had hit our lives in the past few days, it was justified. No parent should ever have to see their child suffer, certainly not with cancer, but fate had played its cards with Ayyan. I walked around, my shoulders heavy with the weight of helplessness. I didn't utter a word to my family who waited outside. I wasn't in the mood to speak to anyone. Just let me be for now, I thought to myself, and they did. They were too tongue-tied, too shaken up to speak themselves. I pulled out my phone and unlocked the screen mindlessly, more out of habit than anything else. On opening the WhatsApp messenger, I noticed that all my friends and loved ones had changed their profile photos to the same picture that I had put up. It was an image from a Batman film where the bat symbol is projected from a skyscraper onto the night sky. Everyone had heard of the story that I had concocted for Ayyan about transforming into a superhero, and changing the display picture was their way of expressing solidarity. I was deeply moved by this simple gesture. I saw a few more texts from people expressing their sadness and pledging support. I was touched and replied to each of them, lest I forget later. And then I saw a text from a prominent producer. I was scheduled to shoot for his film. He had, without consulting me, cancelled shoots indefinitely, even though it would cost him and the production house a lot of money. This had my head spinning again. My professional life seemed uncertain, but that was the least of my concerns at this moment. However, could I ignore that part of my life for too long? I locked my phone and slipped it back into my pocket, making a mental note to respond to him later when he would come to visit. Wanting to be alone while the operation was in progress, I went up to the 8th floor of the hospital to sit in the room that we had reserved for Ayyan the night before. It was a hospital suite that overlooked the sea. I stared at the gushing waves with the amulet still clutched in my palm and prayed like I had never prayed before. It was 2 in the afternoon and the operation was going to go on for another couple of hours. Dr. Uma Ali, who I fondly referred to as Uma Auntie, was a family friend. She had tutored a lot of the staff at the hospital and they looked up to her. She gave me hourly updates about the progress and vitals of the surgery from the ICU, and that helped me get through the 4 agonizing hours. "We are going to get through this," my wife said as she sat beside me, a tinge of worry showing in her eyes finally. "It might be a long road ahead, but we will." Burying my head in my hands, all the possibilities, especially the bad ones.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.